Now, you launched a new app, or you're launching it today?
No, it's been launched, Karen, and actually we're so excited because the team has devoted a lot of resources in really thinking about how to deliver the best, most seamless digital experience.
Okay, now what makes this app unique? I mean, there are banking apps.
Absolutely.
They exist.
Absolutely. So, well, in addition to making adjustments to the user experience, so the team has really thought about, together with specialists, global specialists, thought about making sure how every click can be as seamless and as easy, least amount of clicks to get to what you need to get done. So we've added a number of features, but really what we're so excited to share more about, which is first in the country, is the fact that we've launched this track and plan feature. So we feel what's missing, I mean, many banks can offer the same, you know, send money, deposit a mobile check, mm-hmm. all of that.
Or transfer.
Transfer, yeah. Exactly. What differentiates us is really the fact that this app goes beyond the day-to-day transactions. It
okay.
really helps you manage your finances and helps you towards your goals.
Like how?
So it actually, you can set kind of budgets for different spend types. You can set goals around, if you want to set a goal for save up for a trip to Bangkok, let's say, or save up for your kids' education, college education, or save up for a house. Today, the app gives you nudges around to let you know what you're spending, what you're receiving in your account. And that we've gotten a lot of great feedback from people.
So how is artificial intelligence used in that app when you say it gives you a nudge?
Yes. So it's actually very personalized to the information we have about you. So the app and the model studies, again, your transactions and your habits within the app, and is able to then tell you whether you are spending more on a certain category, whether you have a certain inflow that you might not have expected. For example, if you've received a payment, it allows you to understand what's coming in and out of your app that might be irregular to your usual habits. So for example, if you've received an inflow or some cash that might be more than your usual monthly, it might invite you to consider a savings account that might have a better rate or even an investment.
Would it do that?
Yes, yes.
Really?
And people are really excited about that because I think it really takes it to the next level of helping Filipinos achieve financial wellness.
Okay, but how does the app make you understand? I mean, investing money isn't easy.
Yes, and we're very cautious, right, about that, because generally, and again, it's all very personalized. So depending on your risk parameters, meaning we do a quick assessment of your profile, so you're able to input, you know, how comfortable you are with certain types of risk, what your investment profile might be relative to the time frame you're willing to put that money away. So we're quite cautious, but with that, understanding that information, we can then help you. We can point you to a few different products that might be suitable. And for some people, it might be a time deposit, which is a little bit safer, maybe a lower rate than equities. But for some people, it might be a mutual fund or a set of funds that can help their funds grow a little further.
But are you saying, Mariana, that the paperwork is gone? When I invested recently, I had literally an agent come over. I mean, a financial expert.
Yeah.
And I signed a few
documents.
How
many pieces of paper did you sign?
A lot. Are you saying now you won't be signing anything?
That's our CEO, T.G. Limcauco's biggest pain point. He really wants to do away with all the many pages of signing that we do.
Yeah.
There are regulatory requirements that we comply with, but for certain types of investments today, UITFs and mutual funds, you are able to do it end-to-end via the app without ever having to interact with a piece of paper
or a person.
Oh,
yes. My gosh. I'm really a generation older. But then what about security? Feeling... it won't make me feel safe. You know what I mean? How do you address that?
Yeah, no, I think generally that's a very fair point. I think for a lot of people, there's comfort in interacting with a human. And so we offer a truly digital approach. I mean, we still have branches all over the country where, you know, if you feel more comfortable to be able to interact with someone, have a discussion about the different investment options, that's there. We also offer virtual relationship managers. So they're not bots. They're actual people that you can access via a dedicated hotline.
Okay.
And so if you have a quick question about the investment opportunities that are up in the app, they can walk you through it. And in terms of security of the app itself, we really invest and double down in that. We have some of the best kind of cybersecurity specialists from around the world.
But what was the primary target of BPI in terms of this app?
So we realized that it's really, I mean, to be frank, it's really targeted towards a more digital Filipino. But we want to, we've built it, and this is part of the why we, part of why we've released an entirely new app, because we've built it on an entirely new tech stack that allows it to evolve and be buildable in nature, which means in the future we can make it more specialized to different types of people. So today it's quite general in nature. I think it's for, we'd like to think that most any Filipino interested in banking services will find it useful, helpful, and relate to their needs. In the future, though, we see a world where it'll become more specialized. We understand that there are clients with more sophisticated needs. We want to make sure that they're equally as excited and fulfilled by what we're offering. And there are some Filipinos that require or are more comfortable with simpler products and simpler technology. So we hope to cover the range.
Okay. Now, I'm curious overall, how would you describe AI in the Philippine banking industry? Where are we when it comes to our neighbors?
Well, I think we're definitely learning. I understand there are many banks, many companies use with different applications. I mean, I spoke mostly about applications that affect the client directly. There are so many ways in which AI can help us in managing our own operations and making things more efficient. I mean, think about things like loan approvals, right? That, you know, require many different steps of credit approval. And if you think about any back office processing,
yeah.
I mean, we're personally really excited about an application that we're testing, which is developing a portal for any of our frontliners to be able to access questions they may have. So if a client comes to them with a question that might be complex, they can input it in the portal and it can help guide them towards how to answer the client.
Okay.
So it'll help streamline everyday work for those at the branch, right? So they could really focus on giving the best advice possible to our clients rather than dealing with, you know, administrative tasks and remembering many different processes and protocols.
But I'm curious, when you said loan approval, you mean there's an AI that's being developed, and what will it do?
It's in the future. I can't say it's necessarily in the works right now, but I do see a future where we will use AI to be able to improve our credit management. You know, I think right now in the Philippines, it's a little more challenging than other countries, as we don't have a standardized credit system that's managed by the government. So we have to use different data points and pieces of information to piece together how we do our credit scoring. And I do see a world very soon where we will be using AI to be able to streamline it. And that will mean quicker turnaround times for people that are applying for loans at the bank, right?
Yeah.
Another big pain point.
Yeah. Because now how many days is it?
It depends.
Yeah, it can take months for some.
It depends.
Yes.
I mean, we do have like personal loans that are very quick turnaround. Loans that are collateralized, so meaning where there are assets behind them, we have to make assessments on those assets. It can take a little bit longer.
Okay. Now, what about AI for fraud detection?
Yes, we are very excited about that.
Yeah.
I mean, as you know, that's been such a pain point, not just for Filipinos, but for people around the world. There's phishing, all different types of fraud that's going on. And we think that this can help us better assess and manage different points where it's going on, so that we can immediately act on it.
Do some of your employees feel threatened that the bank is moving towards AI?
I think everyone nervous, employees, non-employees, right? Because it's a new world. But I think at BPI we've been very clear that this is an opportunity to relieve people of having to do day-to-day administrative tasks, right? It'll give them more time to focus on value-added services, which means that they'll grow in their careers. It's a moment of upskilling for all of us. And so we framed it as a chance to really offset some of the day-to-day tasks that might be taking up their time, allow them to streamline things, and give them a platform to kind of lift and offer better servicing and better advice. Because we really want those in our branches, our relationship managers and our bankers, to spend time giving advice rather than having to manage paperwork.
But then we saw just recently Mika, the experimental CEO of a Polish company. She said she's devoid of personal bias, no weekends, is on 24/7.
Well, you know, I find it interesting because I do think also we're living in a world now where people are starting, especially post-COVID, to really value a work-life balance. So I do think that we're in a place now where we can leverage technology and even AI to allow for us as human beings to enjoy more of our lives, right? And spend more on time spend more time on things that matter.
Where do you see the banking industry in the Philippines going?
Well, as I'm sure you know, BPI has invested heavily in digital. Actually, we were one of the first to make kind of major investments in our core platform upgrades, one of the first to offer even ATM banking and now digital banking. I do think we're seeing that with the kind of growing generation that's becoming decision makers and kind of the larger percentage of our workforce, it's undoubtable that digital is going to be a major channel of choice. Mm. That being said, we're still really excited about the offering that our branches and relationship managers can give because we noticed that many of our clients and many Filipinos still prefer to have that physical interaction.
Do you know, every time I go to a BPI branch, the lines are so long.
Okay.
That is, that's seriously.
So we are using technology to also study that and understand how we can offset that. But I think...
But there's a psychology there too. There's a security being in a bank.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
As I go to the bank.
And that's part of the reason why you'll notice our strategy as BPI is that we've maintained our branches and we are even growing in some areas. Because we do think there are areas of the country where it's more important for people to have that physical interaction. So we're very resolute about this digital strategy. We're investing heavily in our digital platforms, but we want to make sure that also people have the option, because it should be... We call it omni-choice. It should be the choice of the customer as to how they want to interact.
But then what about the issue of privacy? I mean, here is a new app that will nudge me and say, hey, extra money came in. Would you want to invest here?
Yeah.
Or you're shopping too much. Will it say that?
It will eventually, if you mark certain categories that you want to manage. So it'll tell you you're spending more on gas than you usually would, or it'll tell you your Meralco bill or your utility bill is higher than it was last month. So we think that these are helpful nudges. We're very cautious about data privacy. We're obviously, you know, heavily managed and overseen by the BSP, and we're incredibly compliant with all of that. But we do think that using your own data for your insights could be a useful exchange. So it's all very personalized.
And how do you assure customers? You saw what happened to PhilHealth. I mean, there's ransomware. It was for rent. And it actually breached 72 systems.
Yes. It's something that keeps, I think, all of us up at night. And I think what we've done is we've really invested heavily in global level consultants to help oversee and manage a lot of our cybersecurity. Because at this point, no stone can go unturned on that. We really feel that it's something that we would continue to overinvest in to make sure that everyone is protected.
Okay. I know that you don't have enough time, but I want to go personal a bit here.
Sure.
You are the third generation. Is that fair to say? Third or fourth?
I'm actually, Karen, I'm an eighth generation member of the
Ayala
family. Yes, yes.
So, no, you mean your father would be seventh? No, but
that's right.
Your grand... I can't imagine.
Yes, well, I mean, in recent past, people
have... No, like the development of Makati.
Yes, actually. So that's actually even previous to my grandfather's generation. Yes. So I do represent an eighth generation, which is something I'm very proud of, and I don't take for granted.
But no one would ever think you're eighth.
Yeah.
People would often say, Mariana, she's the third.
it's quite unique, I think, in the world of family business. So it's something we take seriously and keeps us hustling.
Okay. Now, your family has kept such a stellar reputation all these years.
Thank you.
What do you think is the secret in terms of succession?
Well, I think, you know, if you look back the past three generations, there was and maybe that's part of the reason why people kind of view us as third generation, there was a decision in the generation of my grandfather and my father and in my uncle to
the
to
70s really,
right,
to professionalize.
And I think they realized, and this is something we all share as a family, that no one gene pool can necessarily have all the skills and talents to be able to address the many needs and opportunities in the country. Mm. Ayala, we're lucky to be a very diversified business, you know, from telco, banking, real estate, energy, healthcare, and more. We really want to make sure we identify the best people to be able to take those opportunities forward. And that might not necessarily come from our gene pool. Mm. You know, our CEO, who's been president and CEO for the past year, Bong Kun Singh, is actually the first professional CEO that we've invited into the company, though the CEOs of our business units have been professionals for many years.
Yeah.
So it's a very resolute strategy, and I think it's the reason why we have been successful, is that we've been able to really identify some of the best talent in the country and globally to be able to help bring things forward.
Okay, and not only that, you had to train and actually earn this job. Is that fair to say?
Yes.
Because one would think, oh, she's Jaime's daughter, she gets the post.
Well, there are benefits that come, I think, for sure. I'm not immune to that. But I've been with Ayala for 10 years. Before that, I worked for a bank in New York City, and that was very helpful for training, understanding how large organizations work, understanding how to get things done. Previous to that, I had summer internships every year I was about 15. So I got to experience many different work environments. And with Ayala specifically, I had the chance to work, in an Ayala Corp and also with Ayala Land and now with BPI. And so I've been lucky to have a number of different experiences. And it keeps me humble.
Yeah. But will you stay in the banking industry?
Well, Karen, I also serve on the board of Ayala Land. And so it's a space that I've been quite involved in.
Yeah.
As well.
And what excites you more? I mean, BPI, you're here for BPI, but I'm curious.
Yeah, well, you know, I think a lot about what the commonalities are between the two, and I realize what excites me is the consumer and the Filipino consumer. I think we're at an inflection point right now where the consumer is evolving. And I find that the Filipino consumer is really adaptable. We consume trends, we consume digital at a super high pace. So the idea of kind of keeping the consumer excited is something that it's a challenge for me that I really enjoy. And I realize that's what brings together, you know, my work at BPI and building these kind of consumer platforms and experiences. And similarly in Ayala Land with, you know, creating environments that we want people to love. Those are challenges that I really enjoy.
Now, clearly you're a new breed of leader, but what have you learned from your grandfather, your father, even your uncle?
Yeah, you know, all of them have always stayed very true to their self and their values. So even in kind of the toughest times and the toughest decision making, it's really their values that ground them. And that's something I take with me every day.
Mm-hmm. And not only that, I was going to say, this is woman power, right? The big honchos of Ayala were Jaime and Fernando, men. And now, is it fair to say, one day it could be Mariana?
Oh, I'm not sure about that. But there are many wonderful women leaders in Ayala, actually. If you look at BPI alone, a large chunk of our senior vice presidents and executive vice presidents are women. Same can be said for other units, such as Globe. And so it's really fun to see, and it adds a different kind of layer. I always say that the idea of kind of women empowerment is one of national importance, right? It's about making sure that we can put all the best talent forward to bring the country forward.
All right. Anything you'd like to add before we go?
Well, thank you so much, Karen. I'd really love to invite all of your audience to download the new BPI app. It's available in the App Store. We will be decommissioning and turning off our old app so that we can focus on giving you the best app experience in this new app. I promise you won't be disappointed. We spent a lot of time and resources making sure that it's focused on exactly what the consumer needs to achieve financial
wellness. Okay, so just a clarification before we go. If you have the old app, yes, will it not work anymore?
To clarify,
or a sign will come out.
Yes, and you should already see that sign in the dark. So it's a dark red icon in the App Store and the Play Store. That is what is the previous old BPI app. That actually, as of September 30, will no longer be functional. So we've given our clients several months to be able to transfer to the new BPI app. Please look for it in the App Store, the Google Play Store. It's a light red icon, and it has a number of new features and experiences that we think will be very exciting to everyone.
All right. On that note, thank you so much, Mariana, for joining me today.